Good evening, everybody. I'm Nancy Spector. I'm the artistic director, and David and Jennifer Stockman, chief curator here at the Guggenheim. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the Elaine Turner Cooper Education Fund Conversations with Contemporary Artists program, which is a program we've had in place since 2001, thanks to the generosity of a donor, Elaine Cooper, who was part of a number of our acquisition committees, and this fund was created in her memory, and so we're very grateful to her family. This program is it's otherwise called Reflections on Artistic License, and this is the third in the series of six programs with each of the artists who have curated a section of that show. And before introducing Julie, I'll just say a few words. We'll be talking very specifically about Julie's contribution to the exhibition, but just as a background, this exhibition focuses on our collection from 1900 to 1980, and it was a very specific set of chronological parameters for the artists who all six of them have had one-person shows at the museum: Richard Prince, Sai Ko Chang, Julie, Carrie Mae Weems, Jenny Holzer, who am I missing? Carrie Mae Weems, is that all six? I'm forgetting.
Richard Prince.
Sorry, I should write these things down. And each of them were given complete carte blanche to come into our storage and think about a theme that they would like to explore, working with our collection. And it was quite amazing. As a curator here, and I'm sure Joan, who I'll introduce in a second, can attest to be able to be in our storage with artists and kind of seeing how they would approach all of our holdings and many objects which we have not shown previously. And each ramp of the museum, there are six, is a separate exhibition theme, a universe unto itself. So tonight we'll be talking about Julie's contribution and her choices, as well as her work and her exhibition here is where we'll start, which was a commission that actually Joan Young, our director of curatorial affairs, curated with Julie at the Deutsche Guggenheim in Berlin when it existed in 2008.
Mm, 2009.
So I will turn this over to Joan first to properly introduce Julie, and then we'll just have a conversation, and toward the end there'll be time for question and answers, and just a couple of housekeeping notes, if you will. Please, no video recording or flash photography, and thank you for understanding that. And if you do have questions, feel free to come down. There are microphones toward the front of the stage. Thank you.
Great. Well, as Nancy said, we wanted to start off just with a little bit of discussion of your work, Julie, before getting into the selection that you made and into our collection. So Julie, of course, an esteemed figure in the recent practice of painting, particularly abstract painting, widely recognized for her layered compositions that engage issues of history, colonialism, geopolitics, global uprising, the diaspora and displacement. It was over 10 years ago, probably like 15 years ago, where we first discussed, I think, a commission for Deutsche Guggenheim. And these are some examples or installation views when the show came to New York then in 2010. You were living in Berlin at the time, here's another installation view. And I was interested in, I thought if you could talk a bit about how you responded to that context in these works in terms of some of the subject matter that is addressed in them.
So just to begin with, I'd just like to thank you for this opportunity and the opportunity, and thank you all for coming. It was kind of an immense pleasure to go through the collection and to have the opportunity to put something together, or to really kind of, more than even put something together, to really think through how one could like approach this vast collection of work and rethink kind of my responses to it all. And so that was it was really instructive more than anything else. And I wish many artists had that type of opportunity, because it really you really start to understand what how much work is back in storage. Like how much in this is one place of all these institutions, how much work is never seen. And there's something about that that's really humbling and really instructive in an intense way about also then what do you, how do you engage with the work that you want to see. So thank you for including me and for asking me to be here. And also for me it was really kind of an immense moment to put together these paintings in 2007, 2008 for this show in 2009. And to have that show come here and have my first museum show in New York be here at the Guggenheim, this building that has been so important. And it's a museum that I've come to and looked and the work that I've looked like really been really important to me for a really long time. But the kind of total gazoom, the kind of total artwork that is this building is momentous. And I think as it stands as an icon for a reason, and I think it was really a tremendous thing for me to be able to show my abstract paintings inside of this institution. So to go back to this moment of thinking around these paintings, I was, been doing a residency in Berlin at the American Academy, and I have to say that before I went to Germany, it wasn't a place that I was really attracted to. I had had an exhibition there and been in a show there in the gallery, but it wasn't a place that, but when I went there for this residency, it really moved me, and we went back to do this big commission project, and I worked on these paintings while I was there. And the big commission project, I think we're going to talk about it a little later, is a huge painting I did for 200 West Street, the Goldman Sachs headquarters, or going to be headquarters, and it was a big painting that I titled Mural. And that painting was really this look at kind of, we'll get into that in a minute.
Do you want me to shoot ahead to that?
Maybe, because that kind of, these paintings are made, so this painting, while I worked on this, I got rented a huge studio that used to be a munitions factory, and on one side of that studio, we built a wall where you could put these paintings, this entire painting could exist in full in that studio, and I was working on this, and on the other side, I worked in other studios on the gray paintings that were then, and the new work for the commission here. And without spending too much time talking about these, this painting, to me, it's a painting where the hard-edge geometric kind of shapes and hard-edge uniform color, kind of monocolor shapes were reign supreme in their kind of their orchestration and in how they operated symphonically across this painting. And so in a way, this painting is the arc of 10 years of the paintings I had been making before. Every painting that I had made before that, and every painting or public artwork that had this type of language in it that I was quoting from was also incorporated into this painting. So it was this massive other lens, if you will, and exploration. And so at the same time as doing this, which was almost a culmination of a language and a way of thinking and working on a different kind of symphonic operatic level, then I started to really, while I was in Berlin, rethink how I was working with the architecture and the other paintings and develop this kind of third gray space between the erasure and the architecture and the ruin. And that's really because I was living there, sorry for your slide presentation. I was living in Berlin, and you can't avoid, especially as an American in Berlin, in the midst of the quagmire of the Iraq War, and as a citizen of this country, you have to be responsible for that action and the kind of complete decimation of this place, of this historic place of all of our kind of unified history, but this eradication, this very violent eradication of place, space, displacement, and being in Berlin it was really, you know, there's a play, that's a city that has really taken responsibility in many ways for its role as, and its, and a lot of the way the citizens engage and participate in education, the monuments, the real kind of effort to come to terms with their complicity in the Holocaust and in the Second World War, and what the many levels of that devastation is moving, and it's very, it created this immense mirror for me as an American there during the Iraq War. And so that was this place that I was trying to make these paintings from, while I was also making this other, like, this very other, this other immense painting. But, so to go into these in depth, I think these are paintings where all the drawing, all the architectural drawing are ruins. They're really ruins from Baghdad, Afghanistan, part of the part of some historic ruins here in New York, but really looking at that situation and building these possibilities from within the ruin and from within the gray and erased space, and looking at erasure as this place of possibility, and I think the whole tenor of my work really changed, and that's why I wanted to talk about the color painting, which was this where the color shapes were supreme over the drawing, mm-hmm. over everything else, and at the same time you had that suprematist gesture, and then you had this very different exploration happening at the same time.
That's what was fascinating to see. I think you work on them simultaneously, though, to see that engagement with the social and political context that is always part of your work, even as an abstract practice. And continuing thereafter in works involving, you know, addressing Arab Spring and other contemporary events as well, to see that, but also to see that new, I mean, these are the typical layering of canvas. Oops, there, you can see. And that these are basically thin, transparent layers of acrylic, I believe,
yeah.
With the architectural renderings, the geometric shapes, the gestures. Can you talk a bit about what those, I mean, are these different languages that you are in?
Yeah, so
that
this painting,
combine?
Berliner Plots, is a painting that it was, this was really the painting that kind of focused the other paintings on this, I thought, thinking around Berlin, but the other paintings, really the architectural language, come from Baghdad, or from not just Baghdad, other places in Iraq, but also Afghanistan and Kabul. And this painting, though, are these buildings, a particular form of housing that was built in the turn of the century before the war, and all of these corners had been erased or had been bombed. And so most of these buildings, very few, still exist. But these buildings are very common when you drive around Berlin now, or when you experience Berlin now. These are what you see all through the East and the West, and more so in the West. I mean, you see a different version of these in the East, but they, and the way that I drew them, this is a detail, if we can go back to the mm-hmm. other previous one, they're flipped, and there's a kind of horizon line in the center of the canvas where the building is drawn at the bottom, and then it's also drawn in reflection upside down. And so there's this psychological space of like a reflection, and you're not sure if you're looking into this water or if you're looking up at where this reflection is. Is it in the sky? It becomes this kind of other whirlwind of space. And the white shapes and gray space in the paint in the first layer add to the kind of linear dynamics that are drawn from that appear from the drawing of the windows or the drawing of certain pathways or the streets on the corner, the details in the building. And so when you're walking through the painting, these are one image, one photograph of a square layered on top of another, there it's almost like there's a type of vertigo that you experience. And if you go to the detail again, you can kind of see what happens when the windows are layered on each other. But you really you start to have this physical experience with the painting, this visceral experience. And I was mostly interested in that, and that this was an erased place. This was this kind of image or imaginary of this place that didn't really exist in the same way, although it does, because it's also the remnants of that are there. And for me, it was this conceptual space to that created this discomfort as you're experiencing the painting, as well as this idea of a totalizing view. And I was interested in both of those as a context for these other paintings, and this being this historical lens of this contemporary moment.
Mm-hmm. I'll just jump in to ask a question about the relationship between performativity, the physical body, and making the painting, but also our experiencing of the painting, because thinking that you were working on this with this, these valences of history and the disappearance of a certain urban scape, but also with the Goldman Sachs mural, which is encountered, obviously by the people who work there, but it's also, I see it driving by mm-hmm. on a regular basis, and it's such a thrill, but there is something about the motion, too, of seeing it that way. And I'm just wondering what your thought process is about this notion of kind of the performing viewer and the performance it takes to make something of the scale. And
I really think of these, they are these, I think of them as these performative spaces, without a doubt. And there's, and in this painting, all of these paintings, one of the reasons most of these, this painting is really large, but the other paintings that I made for here are also quite large. They're 10 feet by, I think, 14 10. Feet. Mm-hmm. 14 feet wide and 10 feet tall. And they're, so, and the marks are quite small. And the paintings I'm working on now are smaller, or some are at that scale, but there's a different scale to the mark, and there's a different scale. In these, it's really, I think it can't be avoided that there are these different experiences of the work and your understanding of the work from where you are and how you view it and how you participate with it. So this painting is hundreds of paintings when you come up to it, and it becomes a very different experience when you're inside the building and you're up against the canvas than when you're up against the canvas. Your head doesn't touch a third of the canvas. Mm-hmm. When you're outside, you see the entire canvas, and when you whiz by it, it becomes this other, you don't see the drawing, you don't see the architectural drawing from the exterior. It's only the color and the shapes and the dynamic between that. And I do feel like there's somewhat of a sonic experience of motion, or this kind of symphonic experience I'm talking about, but I think when you come closer, that really shatters, and it becomes a very different type of visceral experience up close. And so I do, your understanding of that because of your body and because of your motion and because of how you move through it are really amplified, I think. And so in that sense, that there's this intent. And in terms of also anybody working on this, whenever you're looking at something, you think about that there is that dynamic of the trace of that performativity.
Sorry, but one other question, because you talked about sonic, and in your notes on painting, you talk about the beat.
Yeah.
And that really struck me of how you're using a musical term, in a sense, about the rhythm, the syncopation, and I'm just curious, is that something also, in addition to the obviously the optical and now the physical, but is sound, in a way, does it play into, or is it about cadence?
I think both the beat and cadence, I think there's this aspect of intuitive performativity, using that, and this intuitive place of making, where in that space there is this place of invention. And in working intuitively, and I've said this before, but I think it's really important, that it's not working in the dark. It's not just kind of like trying to access some place of non-being. It's a really informed, deeply knowledgeable sense. And I think that, and it's a sense like the sense of touch or smell or sight, but it's a different form of that, of that sense. It's a sense that we don't have language for or can understand, but I think it's accessing a place to work from this place where all these, where it's informed, it's a very informed sense, and I think, and sensibility, and place of performance and invention. And for me, that's apparent in the work, but that's also the place that this work is being made from. Even if there's a lot of thought put into what goes into the work, the actual making of the work is made from a very different place. But I actually do think you can hear these paintings too, as well as how they're made. You know? Mm-hmm. And I think that, especially this painting, I think has this very sonic quality and experience in person. And I think two very different type of sonic experiences colliding into one another. Mm-hmm.
One last question I had about these works, considering their relationship to, as you were saying, you know, Berlin, to the Iraq War, to in mural, sort of the history of capitalism, as I understand, do you consider these works, or how do you consider them in relationship to the tradition of history painting, especially as then you're looking at our historical collection, you know, in this show?
No, I mean, I look at painting constantly. And I travel to look at painting. I look at painting whenever I, you know, go to particular museums. I've traveled to particular places to look at a painting. I care a lot about this language and this history. And I mean, for me, like early history painting and the large history paintings that you can find in the Louvre and such are like really important. And they're also really interesting as abstract paintings. For me, though, like, and the history of the work here, or the history of abstraction, has there are many reasons, like not just that as a visual language have I been really interested in it, but I've been, I think, really informed by my entire life, and my experience has been informed by the ideals of modernist language, modernist kind of. The language of early modernism and that and the kind of desires embedded in that. And I mean that from an internationalist perspective, not from a Eurocentric modernist perspective. And I think that, and so for me, there's a space in abstraction that allows a certain type of freedom and possibility and radicality that's really important. And I think that's been a big part of this tradition that I've been looking at work in. But I don't just look at abstract painting. I mean, I'm really, and I'm very informed by all kinds of painting, not just abstract painting. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Should we move on to artistic license?
Sure, yeah.
Can I?
I think there's another click right
another
there.
Another one? Oh, yeah. Thank you. So, well, before, just to say that I think I speak for the museum and the curators and Richard Armstrong, our director, that we feel very lucky that you accepted the commission and that we are now owners of a number of the works that were made as part of the gray area, mm-hmm. The Deutsche Guggenheim Commission. So even though they're not on view because they're post-1980, even though I did ask you at one point if you'd like to include one, just to say that we're thrilled.
Thank you.
That you're in our collection and that you were willing to go through this exercise with us. So this is just some behind-the-scenes photos to talk about our process, the back of our heads, but actually Morris Louis Sarah Band, which we didn't, and you didn't end up selecting, but the...
But it's one of my... I love this painting.
This was the joy, to hear you respond to works that you knew and had seen before in various, whether at the Guggenheim or when we have lent it elsewhere. So I think let's start by exploring the themes that you wanted to pursue. And it was really interesting, Julie, because of all of the artists, you had a number of themes that eventually intertwined mm-hmm. As when you told us your interests, post-war trauma, how artists respond to trauma, interests of voices from the global south, artists who went outside of themselves in some way, whether it was outside tradition or outside literally by ingesting drugs, because we have the Henri Michaux mescaline drawing, and the shattered body and where that intersected with performance. So that was a lot that evolved over our conversations, but I think it started with trauma, which maybe was responding to current events slightly, or the time we're in, or...
I think even before that, when I first got the immense list, how many works is it in the that were before 1980? It was like,
our collection is actually quite small. It's about 9,000 objects, which is tiny if you compare it to our peer institutions. So, I would say you were probably sent a checklist.
Around 8,000 works, it felt like.
No, more
five. Six.
Probably felt that way.
Five or six.
Maybe 6,000, yeah. 5,000.
7,500. It was a lot.
We sent a database.
I went through every single piece in PDF several times, and I just remember that you're looking at everything at a post, you know, a stamp, postage stamp size. And But I really looked, anything that I recognized and really knew, I didn't really want to see right away. I was more, and I was interested in a lot of the work that I didn't know at all. And I tried, and so we selected a lot of work, and I was interested in work by artists I had never heard of that were in the collection as well. So that's kind of, I mean, I just cast the net as wide as I could and looked at, we pulled up as much of that work that we could. And there is, it was intense to experience a lot of that work, and I don't know how many of those first things I asked to see or actually made it in. Some of it was because didn't make it in because other artists were including that in their ramps, and they had a much clearer understanding of what they wanted to do and intended to do, unlike me. And I really was, I had no idea how I wanted to approach this. And then it was, I think, after our first tour of all the different sites, looking at what was in the collection and what from what I had actually called it, I went back through the entire list again to try to look at, some of the ideas that came up in our conversations while I was looking at that first round of work. And I think, like, so when we were in storage looking at some of this work, you could see other work. And some of it you couldn't see because it was packed up, but there's other work that, were, especially with the flat work, you could see other paintings. Yeah. And through, yeah, there's experiences
you see
like
on
this
the screens,
where
it's a little bit like being in a library where you go to find one volume, but the open stacks idea that suddenly your attention is drawn. And I remembered quite profoundly when you saw the Francis Bacon triptych, which we'll show you when we're going to kind of walk up the ramp through the, and I thought that was a very profound, because that was never on your list, but you knew you wanted it.
And I had to change my what I wanted in my mind, because I wanted to try and show really strong, amazing work by people who I haven't seen exhibited in the museum that often. And there are really some great artists who have been exhibited that I really love, but there were some artists who I wanted to try and show, and there wasn't, that's one of the holes in the collection. There wasn't that work wasn't there in the way that I wanted it, with strong pieces, and I wanted to really show work, you know, you want it to be a meaningful experience. So this was one of our conversations. There continue to be these huge gaps in this collection, and there's a lot of different reasons for that, but so when I wanted to show, like, really try and show artists who come from outside of the history of this tower and this the icon of modernism that is the history of the kind of non-objective painting that has been a part of this institution, and thinking, what are the contributors? What are the other contributors to that? Whether they are the Albers photographs of the different archaeological sites in Mexico, and how much this form of geometry and abstraction has been part of an ancient culture that has been used and is a part of this history of modernism. So I wanted to try and think of how to approach thinking around what was in the collection really differently, and it became difficult because of the challenges of the collection and what I wanted to think about. So then when I saw the Bacon, though, I thought it became really clear there's certain works that are so moving that were artists that were, in a sense, taking some of these issues on then, when they were making them, even though they became part of this, you know, I don't like to talk about it as allowed in, but there really were these very strict boundaries about who could participate, who was allowed, who was, like, given space inside of these institutions and collections and visibility, and those artists who were participating, making, and contributing, but were largely rendered invisible in a historic lens because of them not having space in these institutions. And not just the Guggenheim, but many of the collecting institutions that we live in and learn and understand our art history in. So for me, I started to think about then what is the work that moves me that is also not the work that I had seen or grew up coming to the museum to see. And so this Asher Jorn, do I pronounce it correctly?
Jorn
really is, I think, a phenomenal painting and What did you say? I think you said Richard Prince thinks it's his best painting?
Richard Armstrong.
Oh, Richard Armstrong? Okay, I thought that was a misunderstanding. But there was this, and so I wanted to play then also around certain modernists who were kind of brought into the fray, who were accepted, like Noguchi, but who worked from this very political space within that, like Noguchi, or Winfredo Lam, and the history of why that those artists were brought into the fold in a way. Mm-hmm. And so, yet they were these artists that worked within this politicized space. So it became like this space where, for me, the Bacon offered this intense moment where it could become, in a way, this central painting, this almost like the altar painting in this space where we could deal with all these different social issues. And I think that he was painting during violence, not trying to avoid that violence, but was actually painting the reality, the kind of subconscious kind of dynamic of that violence on the body, on the space, on the society, on all of that image. Mm-hmm. And the first thing my son said when I brought him to the museum, he's like, "You chose that? Why?" He's horrified by that painting, my younger son.
Yeah, it is horrific.
And there is this horror in it. And so, I don't know, that was one of the points where I had to really rethink how I wanted to approach the collection, or not the collection, but just my perspective on the collection.
Mm-hmm. Just to comment on that, and thank you for that explanation, because part of the rationale behind making this exhibition was to really deliberately acknowledge the gaps and to invite artists to help us do that, and it's really a first step. It's nothing to be proud of, but as Julie articulates, it's part of our history and institutional choice and how taste is determined and how, when taste is determined and a canon is created, there are so many voices who have been left out. So this is, I think, the next chapter for the Guggenheim, and certainly post-1980, our collection is very diverse and intentionally so, but we now need to go back and do some very hard work. And also, because it's a very small collection, we're not an encyclopedic institution. It won't be this, one of that. It's how do we work from our legacy? And I just wanted to pick up on another thing you mentioned, and it, I think, ties in beautifully with your own practice, Julie, is that we were founded as the Museum of Non-Objective Painting before it became the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum. And that was our founder, Solomon R. Guggenheim, with Hillary Bay, who was his advisor, who really believed deeply in the transformative potential of abstract art. And abstract art that they believed had no reference point in the real world, so like pure abstraction, as opposed to an abstracted form, which I think you toggle really interestingly in your own work between representation and true abstraction. So that was really our founding ethos, and much of the collection was built upon that. And I think it was very utopian and very aspirational, and of course excluded many different voices and styles and techniques. But to be looking at how abstraction played out, even though there's some figuration in your ramp, but I'd love that it starts out really in the bays with Jorn and Noguchi.
And the Blythe Bonins and Romeo Bearden. And again, the Blythe Bonins are actually made at a different time, but that worked to show them there. But we tried to also somewhat show the works that were made at similar times, whether it was starting with this Bearden, and then also in the room with the bay with the Bury and Bearden, not Bearden,
Byers,
Norman Lewis and the and James Lee Byers and the Daniel Bury. This, to me, that was a really interesting moment, because to put Norman Lewis in this context, when Norman Lewis was not allowed to go into the museums where he could actually experience abstract art and was not allowed, you know, because of living in Jim Crow South, was not even allowed to go into the museums at all. But he was in, and Bury was detained, from my understanding, in Texas for a while.
He was.
And this, some of this work that he was interested in came from the burlap and from some of the materials.
Yeah, he was a doctor.
Yeah, and there's this really interesting This work is made around the same time, right after the Second World War, dealing with really different realities, but they're both paintings of trauma in a way, but also there are these paintings of other possibility and other type and another space of invention. And I was really, just in us hanging them and placing them, there was this really beautiful, this is one of my favorite bays, how the two pieces on either, there's the red hole in the buri and the kind of the kind of negative space of a moon or of a hole or of a sphere in the Norman Lewis, and I think those two just resonate really interestingly in a kind of psychological space. But I think that those, you know, to talk what you were talking about earlier about non-objective art and these ideas of utopia. I mean, what's interesting is that so much of that history was really, it fell in on itself, and its racism was really, it was really kind of exposed, and its assumptions of this world that it was trying to invent as this world that didn't have, that could kind of invent a different type of dream that was devoid of all of that, of the history of racism and history of colonialism and history of violence and history of, that could be somehow, you could have this dream for this other scape was kind of really, it's been exposed for the farce that its intention was in a way. And I think one of the most intense experiences I had of that was when I was in Russia, in Moscow, in I think it was 2011 or 10, there was a, maybe even later than that, it was 14, there was a biennial that I was a part of, and I went to the museums because I had never been there, and I'm looking at all of this work that was made, this early work of, that had this desire in it, and yet it was, it just felt so almost empty and kind of stripped of its potential in a way, and it, because of the current situation in Russia and how that there, any aspiration in that, what that aesthetic was trying to do, kind of was undermined, or in and the assumptions of it were kind of undermined. And to me, there's that, but there was still this there's still this kind of insistence on this dream of this form of radicality in an aesthetic. And I'm super interested in that, and I find it to be really potent and powerful. But I'm bringing that up as part of the context and thinking around how I interact with that work and that and those ideas and that history, even if I'm quoting from it. Mm-hmm.
But I think in this case, with this installation, you've really complicated that story by your choices. And just to point out that the Norman Lewis does not belong to the Guggenheim. I wish it did. Anyone would like
yeah,
to?
Yeah, we had to.
Us now.
But maybe it can.
But Julie really pushed us. And the particular type of abstraction you were keen on, and obviously his work in particular, but we were able to borrow it on the occasion of the show. And it works and resonates so provocatively there, I think. Because he's not an artist this painting was made in 1962, 63.
No, I think it's earlier. It was, let me see.
Right. Cheat. 54.
Yeah, that acquisition would not have happened at the time.
No. Mm-hmm. But it would be great if we could.
So here we are in this bay.
Yeah. Shocked yourself.
Yeah, I afterwards come up and talk to but this bay I find to be so exciting because we've talked about how the bacon really leapt out from the screen, I think grabbed you, reeled you in, and it became a really important focal point for the rest of the selections. This is from 1962. It's three studies for a crucifixion, but Bacon made three studies for a crucifixion in 1947, right in the midst of the Second World War, and that's in the Tate collection. So this is later, but the same intensity, the same kind of tortured souls and shattered body that we've spoken about is paired with David Hammond's body print, Close Your Eyes and See Black on the left, and I don't have an image here, sorry. On the right side is a tiny Robert Rauschenberg gold leaf monochrome square. So this took on a whole resonance of a sort of dystopic altar, this iconicity, this religiosity, its reference to the crucifixion, and then David's work is on a gold background, and it's this his vulnerability, his own body, and to me, I could stay in this bay for hours, and I have. You know, just thinking about these artists who probably have not been read together before, and your combination of them.
I mean, so for telling. Me, it was there's certain art. When I came to the place where I couldn't make this ramp of work that was from artists who weren't from the central part of this historic discourse, meaning not European and not not white male, but essentially that. That this ramp had to be really include all of this work that was really good. It couldn't be this work because the collection didn't have that enough work from elsewhere and by other types of artists. So when I realized that, I started to really look at those artists who really did take on some of these issues, like either Bacon dealing with this kind of psychological space and the reality of violence and history at that moment that he was painting, and whether it was also Guston, and how Guston left, in a sense, this language of opacity and of abstraction and possibility for a language that was much more representational, but always challenging and kind of questioning and subverting, in essence, the kind of supremacy of the white male in that moment. And I don't know of another artist who was working from that position to do that in that way, which was, in a sense, undermining and questioning and challenging himself in this history and in this social history. And so I really was like looking at these social painters, and I think like the Jorn is similar in its effort at trying to deal with violence and the body in space in this post-war moment, the Dubuffet's for different reasons, and then there were many other artists who kind of played with that in their performativity of their images, and so that space of the Hammonds, which was actually a recent acquisition, I felt so honored to be able to include it and to put that in. That was really a core piece for me. The Senga Ngudis were also another really important inclusion. But being able to have this, being able to put these two types of discourses around the body and abstraction of the body in conversation with one another, in some ways it was an intuitive step, but it was also, it felt important. And there's something that happens with that Hammonds print where he's closing his eyes. I mean, there is this aspect of blindfolding oneself or choosing not to see, choosing not to actually pay attention. And there's this context of that in this facing the Bacon and what's taking place in that painting that is somewhat moving. The gold Rauschenberg, the piece that's falling apart, the kind of gold leaf piece, which is like ephemeral piece of. But I mean, that's how it's made.
I know.
And to me, I can't think of like anything like with a chunk of gold or anything to do with gold without thinking of the Gold Coast and this history of colonialism and slavery and. And you know, monetizing this natural resource, but and also the theft of that. And so for me, that's all embedded. Like those geopolitical dynamics are embedded in that as a material, and as a material, it's been used in that way in work, whether it was about a certain kind of glow or idea of in religious iconic painting. It was like there as a type of. To kind of create a certain kind of radiant light or supreme light, and in or wealth, and this is its history. This is what its kind of its essence is. And so that across from the Hammonds body print on gold were also really that was meaningful to me, and the gold framed Bacon's.
And that informed your title for the section.
Yeah,
Cry Gold and See Black.
Yeah, and so the cry comes from the Noguchi title, which is called,
The Cry.
And then David's piece. Yeah, originally I was going to title the ramp every title of every piece in the ramp because I couldn't come up with any. And that was too cumbersome. So we had to choose some words, and it was actually Jessica Rankin, my children's mom, who actually, who I talk about a lot of work with, and she actually pointed out, well, what if you just took a few words like this? And it was like, that's perfect. So it really comes together, I think, pretty well.
So could you talk about the Alan Shields selection? Because I think we were mystified by it a little bit because of all of the conversations we had been having. We love it, and we're thrilled it's on view. But I think that that ramp has this other ethereal otherness that is quite lovely, remarkable, important. But the Alan Shields is the hanging fabric work that is woven, macrameed. And you, I think you mentioned you knew him. And this,
I didn't know him, but I've loved his work for so long. Mm-hmm. It reminds me in certain ways of the reasons why I love Richard Tuttle's work. This kind of shamanistic place of making something out of very, very ephemeral material. But also, there are many reasons I was attracted to this piece. One, because of its history to looking like a reed map of space, mm-hmm. and this idea of mapping and understanding space. But this is this macrame, dyed macrame. It almost looks like something that when you travel and in, for example, in Mexico, and you'll see women working on these very detailed macrame, like tablecloths or bedcloths, and they're really usually precious and made for somebody. Like the really detailed ones are made for somebody in the family, somebody that you love, and they have this very particular history. And there's this very handmade, elaborate detail and enormous amount of work to craft one of those. And this is, I don't know if this was a found one or if this was a made one, I'm not sure, but I know that what went into making that was a lot of work with some fingers. And so I loved that, but to me it was how it responded as a map to space. It reminded me of these Pacific Islander reed maps where you would have the constellation of the ocean but also the sky, but it's this very different form mm-hmm. of abstraction. Mm-hmm. And so it was about this kind of decentered space in my mind, but also there's this ephemeral kind of, other type of desire in the space that I was excited by mm-hmm. or interested in. And then you have these constellations that are in it, as if there's this way to decipher that. And so, to me, I like included it because I liked this imaginary map and mm-hmm. and possible mm-hmm. cosmos that I projected into it. And I thought it was really nice near the Vicuñas, who's been an artist that I've, and poet that I've really admired for a really long time. An old friend brought her to my attention a long time ago, and she just had a show at the Brooklyn Museum mm-hmm. with those hanging, what were they called?
They're the kipu forms.
Kipu. Yeah. And so in a way, that's what I was thinking almost with mm-hmm. the shields. Like, it's a different type of kibu altogether, but in my mind, it participated in this other space. And her marks, if you just have to really look at that painting mm-hmm. and spend time with it and look at Marx's hand and the figures frolicking and what is really taking place in that and what is the desire that's projected from that and the love with which that painting is made. To me, there was that's this weird space, those two pieces. So they're hard to put, but you need that in a story. Yeah. It complicates everything and also exposes the contradictions inherent in all of this, in a way.
Yes, this is the trippiest bay. And on the, in the best sense, and on the, what you can't see, and I'm sorry that these aren't close-ups, and I hope all of you have a chance to see the exhibition. This is the Cecilia Vicuña. She's Peruvian, I believe, and this was a painting made in the 60s of Karl Marx in this fantastical series. It's also on a gold background. It's totally imagined in a quite, almost like faux-naive way. But on the other side are two works on paper by Henri Michaux, the French artist, and one was a work made under the influence of mescaline. So when I say trippy, it's quite literal. And another just very beautiful watercolor gouache. So I do think that they hold space together in a really wonderful way. I think for us to have worked with you and the other artists, we never give ourselves permission as curators to make these intuitive connections because you're told you really can't do that. So it's about demonstrable historical connections, or you know, one person saw this, so they made that. And to be able to work with you and follow your mind as it went from one thing to the next and the combinations that you wanted to make, it's a joy for us, a learning experience, and I'm going to miss that freedom, which is artistic license. Of course, the title sort of says it all in a way, but I think curators should think more about this technique and trusting that gut kind of response.
And for me, all of these works also were about imagining something outside of this center in a way. And whether it was the masculine drawings and trying to get outside of the body to kind of invent something else. And they're in a ways about escaping and finding ways of thinking of other potentialities, but also escaping oppression or authoritarianism and or prescriptive kind of ideas of being. And so that's another reason that I was like whether how we put them together, but I knew that I wanted to include all of these. Mm-hmm. They kind of ended up in the same bay, but without having that, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like,
so here we have a very early Richard Serra tearing lead on the floor. The Senda Ngudi performance related photographs Julie mentioned, an African American artist, and we added this. We had been thinking about this work for an acquisition, but accelerated it very much so it could be included in the exhibition. And then on the left side is another David Hammond's body print that Julie generously lent to us for the exhibition, which kind of works beautifully in this bay that looks at a kind of performativity, whether it's the tearing lead as an expression of the materiality of this substance that he was experimenting with in the late 60s, early 70s. The performance photography is around the same time, though printed much later. And David was making body prints then as well. So it was interesting, Julie, maybe you'd want to, we originally had our Jackson Pollock Ocean Grayness painting, which you saw in a very early part of this presentation with us looking at it on the screen. And then traded it out, and that would have been meaningful too. But if you could maybe speak to this combination, or
the tearing lead piece is such a physical, like it's such a you feel the performativity of that and what it does and what that kind of what that means, and it's and the same idea of, like, for me that's a very, you know, there's a definite social performance and social kind of expression in something, in an act like that. It's not, I mean, it's really about when you tear up a piece of paper, it's a very particular gesture. To actually tear metal is also this even more of a forceful gesture. And so I love how they work together visually. The Hammond's piece is not just, I live with it and I look at it every day that I would go to the studio. I think, I have to try and make a piece that could even come close to that. Like, if I could make a piece even half, like partially there, that it's such a powerful piece. And the reason is, and it takes so long to see it, is that there's this third eye in the center of that piece staring out at you from its mouth, from the mouth of, and it's incredibly moving. So look for that when you see it. But the whole structure of that piece and the trace of his body, his fingers, the puzzle pieces, what happens in that space, what happens in the space of the trace of his body and his hair and his breath, is there. And then you feel that in the web of the Ngudi, these performances. These photographs. And the way, for me, it was about the constellation of this happening at the same time, but also thinking of the Serra differently, thinking about that in this at this time, but also just putting this work alongside each other, because a lot of times, even though maybe these artists weren't in conversation, they were making at this similar time, and that there's certain, you know, the Sarah has entered many, many, many institutions, whereas, you know, we haven't had a solo show of Singa Naguti in any institution that I know of, and I think would be, she's an artist who we could, would be very instructive and is really important in our history and would be phenomenal to have a, to have that experience. And I think same thing with David Hammonds, who has had a different kind of visibility in the in this history.
Oops, sorry, pointer.
So I was really excited that the Guggenheim acquired that and made that trip ticket, could make it possible.
And this is the last ramp on the last bay on the ramp, and it's a combination of a painting by Yuka Nasaka, mm-hmm. who's an artist who's involved in the Japanese movement Gutai, which was the late 50s into 60s, a kind of deconstructivist attitude toward making painting. And this, when you see it in person, it's kind of insane because every circle was created in aluminum, I'm sorry, in ceramic, like on a record turntable, and then sprayed with a metallic covering. And then it's so hard to describe. The work on the ramp, the web wall, is by a German artist named Mary Bauermeister, who's in her 90s. And it's this wonderland. It contained almost like a, if you think of a Joseph Cornell box on acid, which I realize I continue to bring up tripping metaphors, but it is layered, and there's text and spheres, and there's marbles and glass. It's kind of wonderfully crazy, eccentric. And here's a little bit of a close-up, but it doesn't do it justice.
So when I first saw the big painting, I couldn't see it in person in with all the panels because mm-hmm. it's stored, and they were able to open one panel and then show the layout of how the five panels, I think it's five panels, come together. Mm-hmm. But immediately it created this experience of seeing one panel as this, again, it goes back to the sonic mm-hmm. experience of experiencing a painting, not just because of the turntable dynamic, but because this circular form reverberates, and there's this kind of ripple in the circular form that feels like the face of a speaker or something reverberating sound. I mean, but there's this really weird color. They're not really cold. There's a pink in there. There's this texture and this visceral dynamic that happens when you're in front of that, where it almost suggests this kind of alien continuum, kind of post-human space that's a little scary, but also like, you know, it's like really attractive, but then it's also it's not repellent. That's not the right word, but it's really kind of it's unnerving, and I loved the performativity of that. I loved what that created, and just that there was that piece of that scale. And I think it's one of the pieces of the Gutai that's in the collection, which I think is a really important moment in this period of time and in a way of dealing with this kind of history of violence in the second and the post-war moment, and really from this other place and this period of work that was really trying to invent from that space in abstraction, but really thinking about the post-human condition mm-hmm. and that type of violence and making from that. So that I was interested in that for that reason. And then the other piece I was interested in, because I'd never seen her work before, now I know her work a lot more, and I think she's going to have a show here somewhere soon, or might have a show, like, but not here at the Guggenheim, yeah. I mean, but in... But what that piece is, I used to, when I first started making work and started with these very small drawings, very like little graphic marks, but this was like that on another level. This was like universes of this. This is like when you think about this is like under Buddha's canopies, when all the canopies come together and there are the myriad universes there reflected in the canopies of every universe and every sun and every star and every moon and every little atom into that. Except a little problematic, like there's something really also disruptive about this world that she's building that you look at through these lenses that skew it and that shift it. And you know, it's just a really weird, interesting artist to think about making in a very different way. So I was just super attracted to that piece and found it, I wanted to experience it in this space. But I like this space because it's this weird kind of aftermath space of this very constructed thing, constructed pieces. And then it ends with this piece, the Lawrence Wiener piece, which it's just part of that cycle, I guess.
It really brings out the corporal nature of so much of the work that you selected. Also the notion of end, I think, because of the attention to or the notion of trauma as the kind of catalytic theme that started your thinking about the selection as a whole. So this seemed like a kind of perfect in our round museum to sort of bring it back. Yeah. To the origins of your thinking. So I think we have a little more time. We're going to flip back to your very recent work, because I would love, and Joan, please jump in, to ask you about, because you were making this work and preparing for the show at White Cube in London around the same time that you were working with us.
Yeah.
And when we came to your studio, we saw things in process, which was a real treat. But this, I wouldn't say it's a radical departure, so I think there's your show at Marion's prior to that, with this embrace of blur and the real jettison of pure representation, though I imagine there's some in there. And if you could maybe speak about your experience of curating and looking at this collection and making this work.
So, I mean, I was making this work in this moment, and I think today is a good example of a day where there's a form of like, there's this, you know, I think I was really interested in artists dealing with this moment of trauma or preceding trauma, or, and not just trauma, but exceptional violence, and to, you know, live like we have experienced that in this country, in an epic way, especially if you're of African descent or of Native descent, or you have a very different experience in this country, and your history is a very different. But in terms of in our cities and in the kind of eradication of our cities and the bombing of overhead that Europe experienced, we haven't experienced that on our land in that way, and I'm not erasing, like I said, the violence of the centuries before right now, but I'm talking about this last like 50, 60 years, and I think that there's this dawning of that type of violence and possibility, and there's this other form of extreme violence that we're kind of in the middle of and experiencing and imposing on others, but also many of us are experiencing. And I think that the kind of memory of trauma or the kind of fear of that, of the renewal of that type of trauma. And so this is like the time that we're in. I mean, this is why there's such intense, we live in this moment of extremes, and it, you know, there's this kind of particular kinds of reactionary dynamics to that, but there's also, we live in a time where that's really heightened by social media and all kinds of other polarized political kind of dynamics. Not that we haven't had those type of polarized political histories in the past, but I guess what I'm trying to say is that I'm trying to make work in this moment and trying to negotiate myself and my reality in this moment. And these paintings are informed by the blurred photograph, these blurred photographs that I work from. Some of these blurred photographs there was in the previous slide was the one of the California wildfires. Mm. Another one is enormous number of people that came together the minute the Muslim ban was announced in the airports here in New York and also in Los Angeles, and the number of people that went out to protest that moment, and the collective effort of that. There's that photograph on the blurred photograph that is the underpinning of the painting on the left is a blurred photograph of the car. The moment that car ran into the group of people in Charlottesville, and her name has just left my head right now. And when she was killed, but these intense moments of this year that I was making this work. These are about 8 photographs that I was looking at, but they were like photographs that somehow really resonated with me, and I think within a bigger cultural. Because after this show was up, the following year there was an anniversary of that Charlottesville kind of rally to the right and Antifa response to it, and the same photograph was put back into the media circulation. So these are media photographs. That's what I'm saying, and I blur them only because I'm interested in them as a point of departure for me as more of a psychological space that I'm working within. And I like the trace of color and light and whatever that informed that photograph as being part of the information for the painting. And so then I'm drawing and working inside of these. I think the next painting might, you see like this other, so there's parts of these disembodied parts, there's these different forms of abstract language, but the history of the gesture, the erase gesture, the type of mark, how sometimes a ghostly figure will emerge, or parts of figures, or parts of an eye, parts of something, and it feels like this kind of, they become these kind of visual neologisms of different histories in painting and mark making, and it's interesting because I think a lot of the work I was attracted to and interested in and pulled towards, including in the Guggenheim, resonated in some way with how I was thinking of this, making this work, and my engagement in making this work. So, I don't know, that was a roundabout way of trying
it. I think we can, one more question maybe before opening it to the floor. I would love to hear your thoughts about being an abstract painter today. Working from representational sources, obviously rooted in either current events or very psychically loaded geographic sites, certainly, you know, thinking of the earlier bodies of work. But being an abstract painter as a woman of color and a queer woman, how to occupy that space, because it's not a space that has been typically occupied in the sense this goes back to how our conversation began about the canon and what was excluded. And it feels like a really radical gesture on your part to be emphatically making this work and to be insisting on, and you've spoken about, in the embrace of opacity as a political gesture. So big question, but I would, if you could comment on that, I would love to hear your thoughts.
Like I said early on, I feel like I have been, I think you can, profound works exist in all different forms, whether it's an actual piece of work or a painting, a representational painting or an abstract, a piece of abstraction. But for me, there's a place of ambiguity and a place of opacity that was afforded in abstraction that I think is really important and really offers a place of radical thinking and invention. And I think that a lot of work, and is especially representational work, has a way to be seen, and this is not the way that I always engage with it, but there's a way that it almost works in the way that a word works in terms of a word can be abstract, but it's also very much what it is. So when you say the word toilet, and you look at a toilet, and you see these things, this means this, and there's many other connotations you can put to that word, but it has a very specific
interesting choice.
But I just used it, yeah, no, especially the bacon. But anyway.
Yeah.
But I guess for me, what I was interested in is the kind of space where you couldn't do that to something, where that didn't, where that signifier was ambivalent, and there's this, and there's a lot of space to maneuver in that, and there's a different type of freedom that's created. But we tend to look at everything with either this visceral experience or where we build some form of a visual representation into the most abstract experiences. And so, and you can also, you know, and I'm saying this with a full knowledge that you can have really immensely abstracted kind of content and symbolism in very representational work. But the thing that I really find important is to avoid explaining anything or oneself to an audience. And I think that that's a really essential role, especially for Black artists and for artists. And a space for artists to occupy where you can really, and queer artists and artists of that are really about inventing themselves in a different way. And I think that, and so I say that not as something that you working representationally should be, is something that I'm critical of, absolutely not. Some of my favorite artists work that way, really important artists. But for me, it was a space of a different type of potentiality and a different type of possibility. And I think that it's a space that has been denied a lot of artists if that have to be explained by who they are. And I mean that across the board. I think there's a really interesting show right now at the Sculpture Center that's Sohrab Mohevi curated, which is called Searching the Sky for Rain. And it has a diverse group of artists who are really, in the most part, kind of almost, there's been a denial of abstraction to a big community of us. And I think that historically, I mean, there's a really interesting book that just came out of MoMA called Among Others that talks about the history of MoMA's experience with and relationship with Blackness. And there really has been this kind of an intentional, I can't think of it not being so, denial of this space for artists like us. And I think that it's, so for me, that's a really potent place to occupy. And it also doesn't explain anything to anyone, and that's also a super important place. And I think that's what Gleason talks about when he says, we clamor for the right to opacity. And we have the, and that that's this right, and that's this essential place, and that there's massive amount of freedom in that space that can't be necessarily locked down into a particular reading, and it can be very frustrating, and that's part of the intention of it. Like it can be frustrating to a viewer, and there's an excitement in that, you know, in terms of abstraction as a space. And I think it's also important to understand, like what I said earlier, I think I think about this a lot, about the history of certain forms of abstraction and how they really became forms of expressions of power as well. And so how do you work within that and subvert that is also been really interesting, or is important to me.
Thank you so much.
And I want to add one other thing. I think, just because I do think that actually there's a space where Black artists were really given a lot of space for abstraction, and that is in music and performance.
Absolutely.
And I think that, but I think that there's actually a form of kind of weird understanding of possibility of space, of ownership, of particular kinds of language. And I mean this in the history of racism, in the history of visual language, in the history of social culture, in the history of understanding those type of languages. And that's another reason that I feel like so insistent on the language of abstraction, because of the kind of intense inventiveness that I feel or that I experience when I'm making, but also when I have experienced amazing pieces of work sonically that mm-hmm. also do that, and they offer this other form of language, reality, stammering, possibility, noise, and to me there's something else in that that can be explored. And
that's a lovely thought. Just think, as you're expressing it, I'm thinking about the exhibition that we have right now on view in Tower 7 of Jean-Michel Basquiat, which focuses on a very particular painting in response to a murder of a young artist by the police in 1983, but there are two paintings that are homages to Charlie Parker. And while Basquiat was not an abstract painter, though he flirted with abstraction in a way, certainly, but he was so keyed into that space of music as a place where black expression was allowed at mm-hmm. that time. And he was a connoisseur of that, of jazz, and made many, many works that evoked that freedom. And I just hadn't thought of it in that way until you described.
Yeah, and many of the art painters who were working this way, who have been working within the language of abstraction, many black painters, many women, many people. You know, this really terrific book that I've just begun, Ninth Street Women, which talks about the incredible, enormous contribution to abstract expressionism as a form, even, the mm-hmm. conceptualization of that by these women who were denied being central figures in that history. So there's just this is really important, just revisionist perspective that has to happen and that is in the midst of happening, and that I think was like a little, this was the beginning of a little like peeling that, trying to open a tiny little crack into that conversation a little bit in terms of being able to curate the work with the work here and hoping that there'll be a different form of intentionality at redressing the gaps in the history in the collection here too.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Would you like to ask any questions? I think we have time.
Hi, Nancy. Hi, Julie. Hi, Joan. Thank you so much for this. It's been so rich. My question, well, first of all, so I wanted to say to Julie that I think of the song by David Bowie where he talks through these architects' eyes, because I very much see your paintings, especially from 5 to 7 years ago, as you see the architecture.
Sorry, I can't understand. Sorry,
the it's a Bowie song called Art Through These Architects' Eyes, and I just see this as kind of the eye of the Guggenheim in a way. Anyway, so enough of the backstory. I love to think about the art of the 20th century, the great art being cinema, and the idea of the 21st century about being about conversation and all that entails. So just the question is about how you relate to the art of conversation in all your work. And I see the next stage going, which I hadn't seen before here, but can you reflect a little bit on just the art of conversation and how that could be potentially the art of the 21st century writ large, and you being a leading light of painting and art in general of the 21st century, and how that might relate to you as your story in it.
The art of conversation?
Yeah.
And how you think you see that as the art of the 21st century?
Potentially, yeah.
Potentially. I mean, I think it's actually this moment. I don't know how to talk about something in what, like, I don't know how to, I can't really answer your question.
Maybe the end was, when I first was mentioning it, you're confused. David Bowie wrote a song, said, through these architects' eyes, which was Bowie saying that, but I very much see this museum as through Frank Lloyd Wright's eyes, and you as a painter who really can see the architecture of the whole. Like, I often saw like where the airport is in the society in your paintings from 5 to 7 years ago, which had all these layers, but I see you very much you as an architect too in painting. So what about, I don't know, it just seems like the answer's right there, so I'm just confused.
I mean, for me, I maybe have a more pessimistic perspective on this century. I love that Bowie quote, I don't know. I feel like this is a moment when really nobody's really in conversation or in discourse, and it feels like something where we're moving really rapidly towards a place of further polarization and further kind of protectionist projects. And it feels really like certain types of collisions are inevitable, not just within climate and that catastrophe, but I mean in terms of socially and how countries and places of wealth and capital have to negotiate the rest of the world, which will come flying at them very quickly. So I don't know that conversation will have any role in that. In that world.
That's very helpful. I'm done.
Hi, Julia. I love your work. So you. I was wondering, like, for the commission for the Goldman Sachs piece, like, would you say there's still like a residue of optical space in your work? Like, have you ever been interested in like representation at all, or?
I'm sorry. Who?
Yeah, like for the Goldman Sachs piece, do you think there's still like a residue of optical space or representation in that piece? And then have you ever been interested in representation, or did you sort of try to like avoid it?
In terms of representation?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that even the idea of abstraction representation being these two polar, like occupying those polar realms, can be challenged, and I think that, and complicated, and I think that I play with that and have been kind of playing with that for a long time, and I think that there's a space in between both of those realms that I'm super interested in. You know, if you think of a Pollock splatter painting, that's in some ways one of the most Baroque spaces one can occupy in experience, but it's also this very material experience. But it also becomes a very spatialized type of experience. And so, and in that sense can be somewhat viscerally seen or felt, and something else can happen. And so that shift, that plays, that kind of complicated space is like, that's what I'm really interested in. I'm interested in that gap and in the kind of collision of those polarities, or in that complicated space between them.
Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank our public programming team and our wonderful theater staff and our security guards for being here and making this possible. Please return on October 8th when we'll be in conversation with Paul Chan about his contributions to artistic license. So thank you so much, Julie.